Are we born sinners? Is original sin and total depravity biblical? In this series, we'll consider the doctrine's historic and modern articulations, take a critical look at potential problems that arise, examine the various passages used to teach this, considering the immediate and larger context and the grammar and word choice as we seek to be good Bereans. In this episode, we'll examine three passages found in the book of Job and consider whether or not these proof texts actually teach Augustinian sin doctrine. Augustinians often assert that their teaching of original sin and total depravity can be found in the book of Job. Specifically, they refer to Job chapter 15, verses 14 through 16, Job chapter 25, verses 4 through 6, and Job chapter 14, verse 4. So we will consider each one of these to determine if the text actually supports their claims. What is man that he can be pure? Or he who is born of a woman that he can be righteous? Behold, God puts no trust in his holy ones, and the heavens are not pure in his sight. How much less one who is abominable and corrupt, a man who drinks injustice like water? Now, at a first reading, this may seem to teach original sin or total depravity, but it is extremely important that we understand that simply because a passage is in the Bible doesn't mean that God is speaking or even affirming what is being said. This passage is actually quoting Eliphaz the Temanite, who, in the epilogue, is reproved by God for not speaking the truth about either him or Job. The Lord said to Eliphaz the Temanite, "My anger burns against you and against your two friends, for you have not spoken of me what is right, as my servant Job has." Additionally, even were God to endorse the statements made by Eliphaz, the text is speaking of men who engage in wicked acts, not that man is born spiritually dead, guilty, sinful, and unable to understand spiritual truth as a result of Adam's sin, as the Augustinian asserts. Now, another favorite proof text used by Augustinians is that of Job 25, 4 through 6. How then can man be in the right before God? How can he who is born of a woman be pure? Behold, even the moon is not bright, and the stars are not pure in his eyes. How much less man who is a maggot, and the son of man who is a worm? Again, it's extremely important to point out that simply because a passage is in the Bible doesn't mean that it is God who is speaking or affirming what's being said. We must look at the context to determine the validity of that statement. This passage is quoting Bildad the Shuhite, who, like his friend Eliphaz, is reprimanded by God for not having spoken rightly of him. Moreover, this term translated as son of man is Bain Adam, meaning a descendant of Adam. Now, Jesus repeatedly described himself as the son of man throughout the New Testament, and the gospel writers were intentional in linking Jesus as a descendant of Adam, as this is essential in fulfilling the first messianic prophecy of Genesis 3:15, that a descendant of Adam and Eve would crush the head of the serpent. Bildad asks, how can he who is born of a woman be pure? Well, Jesus was born of a woman. So we see that if Bildad were speaking truth here, he would be saying that Jesus was not born pure, and thereby corrupting the incarnation and our redemption in the spotless Redeemer. So far, we've considered two passages in Job, which Augustinians often point to, claiming the Bible teaches original sin and total depravity. And we've shown how God calls these men liars and reprimands them, and we've demonstrated how their claims would corrupt the very incarnation of Christ. So it's safe to say we should only see their claims as worthy of reprimand and not endorse them. However, in Job 14, Job himself speaks, "Who can bring a clean thing out of an unclean thing? There is not one." Many an adherent of original sin and total depravity will claim that this means mankind is born spiritually dead, possessing Adam's imputed guilt and sinful nature, unable to understand spiritual things. However, the text says no such thing. Here we see Job speaking of ceremonial cleanliness, not an inborn sinfulness, guilt, and inability. The Hebrew word speaking of clean is tahor, and it is used 93 times in the Old Testament, meaning ceremonially clean, and is used throughout Scripture to refer to people, places, and animals. The Hebrew word speaking of unclean is tameh, meaning ceremonially unclean, and is used throughout Scripture to refer, again, to people, places, and animals. We see this state of being clean and unclean dealt with ceremonial purification and not man's nature at conception. In Leviticus 12, we see God tell Moses, "A woman who becomes pregnant and gives birth to a son will be ceremonially unclean for 7 days. Yet, after a time, she is to offer a sacrifice and she'll be ceremonially clean once more." Additionally, if someone came in contact with a dead body, they were ceremonially unclean for 7 days. We also see this use of clean and unclean with regard to Aaron and his sons in their capacity of working in the tent of meeting. Now, looking back at the immediate context of Job 14, we see him make statements which are diametrically opposed to Augustinian philosophy. "Man who is born of a woman is few of days and full of trouble." Now, this means man soon finds himself in trouble. Not that he is born spiritually dead, possessing Adam's guilt and sin nature and unable to understand spiritual truth. "He comes out like a flower and withers. He flees like a shadow and continues not." Now, this means that he is not born dead and depraved, but rather he withers and continues not. Again, meaning that he dies and does not live forever. Of course, if the claims of Augustinians were true, the passage would say man comes out like a dead flower. But instead, it says that he comes out alive and withers and dies sometime after being born. Now, Job goes on to say, "God has determined the number of a man's days and has appointed limits he cannot pass," meaning man is not immortal. Job says man isn't like a tree, which might grow back after being cut down, but rather a man lies down and rises not again. He goes on to say, "If a man dies, shall he live again? All the days of my service I would wait till my renewal should come. You would call, and I would answer you, and you would long for the work of your hands. For then you would number my steps. You would not keep watch over my sin. My transgression would be sealed up in a bag, and you would cover over my iniquity." This word translated here as renewal is also often translated as change. It deals with a change of garments and a relief from death, invoking imagery of a bodily resurrection and transformation into a body untouched by death, and thus clean. Ephrem the Syrian was a prominent writer and theologian of the 4th century. Commenting on Job 14, he wrote, "Here the blessed Job assumes the role of teacher and prophet. And through the symbol of the tree coming to life again, he predicts his return to his former state." So we see this passage in Job is about a return to a previous state enjoyed by Job, further undermining the claims of Augustinian philosophy, which asserts Job was born spiritually dead, guilty, sinful, and unable to understand spiritual truth. Ephrem the Syrian goes on to say that in this chapter, Job prophesies that human nature in its entirety will be renewed. Hezekiah of Jerusalem was a Christian preacher and exegete during the early 5th century. Commenting on Job chapter 14, he noted that in this chapter, Job's focus on death, specifically referring to it as sleep, gives us further hope for a bodily resurrection. So we see the understanding among early Christians on Job was that he was addressing man's consignment to suffering and death while maintaining hope of a resurrection, and not somehow teaching that man is born spiritually dead, guilty, sinful, and unable to understand spiritual truth, as none of this is stated in the chapter. But is there anything additional in Scripture, specifically in reference to Job, which might further shatter the claims of Augustinians? Job chapter 1, verse 1. There was a man in the land of Uz whose name was Job, and that man was blameless and upright, one who feared God and turned away from evil. Clearly, the Bible doesn't teach that Job was born spiritually dead, guilty, sinful, and unable to understand spiritual things. In this episode, we examined three passages found in Job, and we demonstrated how they cannot be used to teach original sin and total depravity. Please be sure to like, comment, and subscribe. Share this series with your friends and family, and please do not hesitate to message us with a specific passage you would like us to consider. Thanks for watching.